Good evening and welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or religious organization. The school is a nonprofit, non-denominational religious and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we incorporated the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch school was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It's been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in His pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within a pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests Himself in a physical body and walks the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Now, after Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. Now, this pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now, the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the devil, the serpent, or dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And ninth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. That was eighth. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. This evening we have prayer by Dr. Joe Ceballos. Our scripture lesson is 1 John, the second chapter. And our scripture leader will be Dr. Kennaway Kleinsmith.
Let us bow our minds and our hearts for a moment of prayer. We are very thankful, Heavenly Father, Yahweh Elohim, to gather us here again one more time to learn of your purpose, pattern, and plan so that we may be able, through these vessels, teach other people, teach other ones that are out there in the world. They don't realize that this gospel, that this charts do take your picture. Once you start asking questions, why is this? Why is that? For example, why the name of Jesus all of a sudden becomes Yahshua? Once you learn, start asking these questions in your mind, you start getting captive. Allow your hearts, allow your minds to be captured into this teaching. This is the only way he said it. Mom, the way, the light, the truth. Please, Yahweh Elohim, enlighten us. We ask this in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, hallelujah.
'cause he missed a soul that he thought he had. And now he's on my track, trying to hold me back. And I made up my mind, and I won't turn back.
Keep on moving,
keep on moving,
can't stop now.
Keep on moving,
keep on moving,
can't stop now.
Satan's on my track, and he's trying to turn me back.
You told my mother, you gotta save your soul. Then you told my brother, what I can make you whole. But God would die for me, out on Calvary. And I made up my mind, and I won't turn back.
Uphill journey,
can't stop now.
Uphill journey,
uphill journey,
can't stop now.
Good evening, class. I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, edited by A.B. Traina of the Scripture Research Association and republished by Mount Yashua Promotions. 1 John 2. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Yahshua the Messiah, the righteous one. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And hereby we do know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of Yahweh perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk even as he walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past, and the true light now shineth. He that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because ye have known the Father. I have written unto you, fathers, because ye have known him from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of Yahweh abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of Yahweh abideth forever. Little children, it is the last time, and as ye have heard that anti-Messiah shall come, even now are there many anti-Messiahs, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out, and they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. But you have an unction from the Holy One, and ye know all things. I have not written unto you because ye know not the truth, but because ye know it, that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Yahshua is the Messiah? He is anti-Messiah that denieth the Father and the Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father, but he that acknowledgeth the Son hath the Father also. Let that therefore abide in you which ye have heard from the beginning. If that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, ye shall continue in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he hath promised us, even eternal life. These things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. But the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and you need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, he may have confidence, and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born in him. That was 1 John 2. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hey, good evening once again. Okay, it's good to see everybody here tonight. Also, hi to everybody out there. Shout out to everybody that's tuning in tonight. And also to Helen out there in Ensenada, Baja California. Send greetings to us this week and send it back to you. Okay, today is Tuesday night, our workshop night. So without further ado, our first speaker will be Dr. Will Williams. Good evening.
Good evening.
It's good to be here. Good to see you all here to learn more of this great and awesome, stupendous, colossal, panoramic vision and revelation given to us by Yahweh our Elohim through the founder of this school, one Henry Clifford Kinley. Okay. As it was stated, this is workshop night. And as I like to say in workshop, this is where we like to get into the nuts and bolts of things. Break it down to its component parts, look at it, examine it, put it back together the way we found it, and run with it. Any questions or comments or suggestions about any topics or anything like that? If not, I'll just consult the old jar. Or as the girl in England say, yeah, the raffle. Kills me.
All right, Dr. Bev Woods, good seeing you here, man, as always.
Thank you. I think pretty much everybody has heard the founder came to California to get this teaching in the movies. What are we doing on the internet if that's not the movies?
Yeah, you know?
And there are echelons and the higher ranks that say, well, you're not supposed to be doing that. Well, you know, don't go on the internet with that stuff. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with them?
Well, you know, I've heard that comment from the very beginning since I first came into class, okay? For us personally, Ontario class, come November, we have been videotaping our class continuously for nearly 24 years. I mean, we go back to the VHS days, okay? And I've learned a lot along the way, and even to the point that I have to kind of semi-retire and let younger folks take over, okay? And just because I remember when, and gosh, oh man, it just seemed like yesterday. But we have tapes. I mean, we really have videotapes. I mean, of gosh, from 1996 on, and places I went to, and you know, that would allow me to videotape the class, maybe get an interview or something like that.
The documentaries, interviews.
I'm sorry?
The interviews you've done?
Oh, yeah. You know, that was inspired by, I had a public access show. I think probably one of the first ones I really did was Rip Macklin. That was probably the first real interview I did, you know, with a person. The first class I did with one was, we had our former dean, that was, what's his name? I know. I hate to be like that. Because he's on video. Oh, gosh. Now, it escapes me now. I hate to be like that. But I'm getting old. What can I say? I know what you feel, Iggy. I really. I even started going to school, just not so, yeah, because I wanted to understand the thing better. And that was really the only reason, you know, just to do it better. And I remember when we first started, and Joe would say, you know, I mean, what's going to be the biggest benefit of it? I try to sell it on all kind of points. Well, we could do training videos. People can look at themselves and see how they, you know, on the floor and help with their, you know, their lectures and instructional techniques and stuff like that. Or like when we started doing the a winter series of lecture, and certain subjects we could have a video of it, say like a video on baptism. Okay, here's a video on baptism, or here's a video on circumcision, you know, things like that. Stephen Brooks, that was our previous dean, okay? I did a video with him once that did that. That was probably one of my earlier ones, okay? It's just, and even now, I'm still learning. I mean, I would never say that I'm some expert, but I do have an idea, you know, what, you know, as far as filmmaking, I mean, what it entails. And it's a lot easier because of technology. Now, anybody can be a filmmaker. I've seen people, I've had classmates make a film just using a cell phone, really. I mean, these kids are really proficient at it. I mean, I'm like, you know, I'm grandpa to them, but I watch them and I see how they're like ducks to water in this, because it's their environment, you know, just like it was when we were coming up. I mean, my dad was a TV repairman, and I remember the days, you know, when TVs were big and bulky because they were vacuum tubes, big vacuum tubes that heated up. I mean, you could having a TV back in the old days was almost like having a fireplace with a window. Because the TV would heat up that much. I mean, you could get warm just, you know, sitting next to the television. I mean, that's how it was until the invention of the transistor. See, and then that made everything smaller. you know, miniaturization and things like that. So, too, and it's still like that. The world that we're in now, this digital technology. Yes, ma'am. How you doing, Miss Sunshine?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Well, I feel great.
Other than your memory.
I know. It gets that way.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we brought it back. So that's
all right. Good. I heard that.
Alan just texted me. He said that you said you wanted to do the four generation of Abraham. Remember from Sunday?
When people do that, okay. The fourth generation. The fourth generation, okay. Someone asked about that.
Okay.
Actually, I got in trouble about it the last time. Well, not so much that, but other things I said on that lecture. But I'll do the fourth generation. Let's read it. It's Genesis 15 and 12. Fourth generation. How about that? Okay. Let's get a basis and then we could extrapolate other things from it.
Genesis 15 and 12. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, mm-hmm. and lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years, and also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace, thou shalt be buried in a good age. But in the fourth generation they shall come hither again, for iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between these pieces.
Okay, good enough. All right, 16th verse. But in the fourth generation they shall come here again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. Okay? Now, the last time I was up here, we talked about Abraham, how he was the first Hebrew. Because Abraham was the one that came from Ur of the Chaldees, and we read, and he crossed the river Euphrates. He was the one from across the river. Mm-hmm. All right, so he's the first Hebrew. Okay, now he walked the length and breadth. We got it right here of Canaan land, but he never set foot on the Promised Land. Okay. Because we had read that the seed had to go down to a land they didn't have, they knew not, but be in bondage, but they would come out with great substance, and they would claim their inheritance. And in the fourth generation would the iniquity of the Amorites become full. And see, the principle is the fourth generation. Here, let's throw this in here. Get Exodus 34th chapter. I think that's what I want. 34 and 1, that should be.
Exodus 34 and 1. And Yahweh said unto Moses, hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tables and the words that were in the first stone tables which thou breakest. And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. And no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flock nor herd feed before that mount. And he hewed two tables of stone like unto the first. And Moses rose up early in the morning, and went up unto Mount Sinai, as Yahweh had commanded him, and took his hand the two tables of stone, and Yahweh descended in the cloud, and stood with him there, and proclaimed the name of Yahweh. And Yahweh passed by before him, and proclaimed, Yahweh, Yahweh El, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundance in goodness and truth. keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and to the fourth generation.
Okay. I know that was a bit long, but that's all encompassing up into that. Because that was told to Moses when he brought the second tables of stone up after he had broken the first set, okay? To the third and the fourth generation. Okay. See, that seems to be a recurring principle here. You know, this theme, okay? Third generation, third, fourth generation. You know, visiting the iniquity upon the children. See, and it said visiting upon the children because the reason why was because prior to that, the man Adam sinned up here in the garden. When he died in his conscience, that death passed on all men, i.e. the children.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect example of this. Jeremiah 31:29. Let's read that. Because see, if it's in the law, then we could see, we could draw something, you know, in, and see something in the prophecy. See, the to corroborate that. And I'm getting some predicates together. Because the subject is the fourth generation. Okay. But for me to really make the subject stand out, I have to get predicates. It's as simple as that.
Jeremiah 31:29.
Mm-hmm.
In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten a sour grape, and the children's teeth are set on edge.
Now the fathers have eaten the sour grape. What fathers are we talking about, and what is the sour grape? The fathers is Abraham. Oh. The sour grape is the olive up here in the garden. The fathers have eaten the sour grape. Read.
But everyone shall die for his own iniquity. Every man.
No, you're missing something here.
In those days, they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten a sour grape.
Uh-huh.
And the children's teeth are set on edge.
See, and the children's teeth are set on edge. Adam ate the olive, and the children died, i.e., all of mankind. The children's teeth are set on edge. Okay, but read.
But everyone shall die for his own iniquity.
But there will come a time where after those days, everyone's going to die for their own iniquity. Is there anything? Go ahead.
Every man that eateth the sour grape, his teeth shall be set on edge.
Now, see, when you do it, it'll be set on edge for you and nobody else. But back here, that's what happened. See, a person could, the children could pay for the sins of the parents. And that was like that in many, many societies like that. See, I know in Asian societies like that, I know we watch these Korean dramas, and like we over there, if you're considered a traitor, that passes on to three generations. Mm-hmm. And you have to wear a particular type of clothing that marks you out as a traitor. As oh, that's a traitor's family right there. You know, that kind of thing. A stigma that lasts not only just to you, but you don't even have any children yet. But then when you do have children, they will bear the stigma of a traitor because you were one. Even though they didn't do anything, they were like, I had nothing to do with this. The fathers have eaten the sour grape and the children's teeth are set on edge. But anyway, this third and fourth generation thing. All right, now, let's see if we can get some more predicates here. This date here. This is the date of the flood. This is 2348. Okay. I'll come over here. Okay, this is the flood, and then after the flood, the end of that age, then we had the Tower of Babel, which was set up afterwards. Now, here's a way to get the date of the Tower of Babel. Let's get Genesis. I think it's the 10th chapter, but it's maybe the 11th.
The Tower of Babel?
No. I want the 11th chapter. I want 11 and 10. That's what I want.
Genesis 11 and 10.
Now, as I said, the flood happened in the year. I'll put it over here. BBY. Okay? And the reason why I know this, since I said it, because here, the antediluvian age lasted 1,656 years. And I might be getting ahead of myself, but when you have 4004 BBY, which is, according to Usher, is the beginning, the creation of the world, because you have the four-year era involved, and then you minus 1,656 years from that, that will give you 2348 BBY for the year of the flood. Okay?
Okay.
Now, what we want to do is determine the year of the Tower of Babel. Now, to do that, we have to go genealogically. Now, if you would just go ahead and read Genesis 11 and 10.
Genesis 11 and 10. These are the generations of Shem. Shem was 100 years old and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood.
All right, now, Shem begat his first son, Arphaxad, and it was 2 years after the flood, in the post-diluvian age, okay? All right, read.
And Shem lived after he begat Arphaxad 500 years and begat sons and daughters. And Arphaxad lived 35 years and begat Salah.
Okay, now, Arphaxad lived 35 years. That would be 35, and he begat Shelah. Okay, read.
And Arphaxad lived after he begat Salah 403 years and begat sons and daughters. And Salah lived 30 years and begat Eber.
All right. And Shelah lived 30 years and begat Eber. All right. 30 years there. Continue.
And Salah lived after he begat Eber 403 years and begat sons and daughters. And Eber lived 34 years and begat Peleg.
Now, Eber lived 34 years and begat Peleg, or 34. And we're going to stop right there. Now, you may ask, well, why are we stopping here? For this reason, we're going to have to go back. And we're going to have to go back to Genesis 10 and 25.
10:25.
Uh-huh.
And unto Eber were born two sons.
Now we just read about Eber. Eber, he had Peleg, but then now this is going to get into a little more clarity. Eber had two sons. Read.
The name of one was Peleg,
one was Peleg, read.
For in his days was the earth divided.
Now, in his days, in other words, in the year of Peleg's birth, was the earth divided. How so? The Tower of Babel.
Oh, okay.
So the year that Peleg was born, that's when the earth was divided. Just finish that sentence.
And his brother's name was Joktan.
And his brother's name was Joktan, okay?
Joktan.
But he was born later. But in the year Peleg was born, that was the year the earth was divided, or the Tower of Babel, those who were at the Tower of Babel, they were scattered. All right? So if that be the case, so now we got these numbers up. So that means that's 101 years from the flood to the year that the Tower of Babel was scattered, or the year Peleg was born. And note, 1, 2, 3, 4 generations. So, all right. So in the year 2247 was the Tower of Babel, which was the fourth generation. See, visiting the iniquity. See, Yahweh's doing that in principle already before he told that to Moses. Visiting the iniquity upon the sons, upon the children of the third and fourth generation. Mm-hmm. See? Okay? So now we see that in the book of the law. Moses wrote about the Tower of Babel. Moses wrote about the genealogies we just read. Okay? And Moses wrote that in Exodus about what Elohim had said, visiting the iniquities of the fathers to the children to the third or fourth generations. Okay? So, let's see if that be so. Now, was it Sunday? Yeah, it was. I kind of jumped on it a little bit. I usually wait till the fall till I start doing some heavy duty chronology, all right, because of the calendar and stuff. Particularly the calendar, because the numbers come out right. But this I can do pretty much any time as far as the 490 cycle, because we went into it the other day as far as Abraham, how his from his birth to the giving of the law on Mount Sinai is 490 years, minus the 15 years that was circumcised out of his life. That is to say, Ishmael. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, I got this up here. 4004. Maybe I should talk about it for a minute. Okay? 4004. Because, really, a lot of people don't understand why we have this number here. Okay. Yeah, that 2520 and this 1490 and or 1491. Technically, this is supposed to be 1490 and a half. You can use either or the dates as far as the date of the Exodus, 1490 or 1491. It just depends on what kind of correlation you're using. Okay. I like to use 1491 most of the time, because most of the time I'm trying to show, particularly 2520, that and at other times the principle of the times of the Gentiles. Okay, first let's see if we can get this straight first. I'll use 1491. Now notice. 1491 years before the birth of Yahshua. Okay? Now, when Moses left and the Israelites left Egypt, all right? When they left Egypt and Moses came up here to Mount Sinai, okay? It was 2513 years after the man had been kicked out of the garden. All right? That means this. AM is 'Anno Mundi, the year of the world. That simply means this. The numbers are going forward. Okay? That's simply what that means. The numbers are going forward. Here is 1,491 years before the birth of Yahshua. That means the numbers are going backwards. Now, these two numbers are the same date. You can say on one hand, the date of the Israelites leaving Egypt is 2513 a.m., Anno Mundi. Or you can say that the birth, that the date that the Israelites left Egypt is 1491 BBY, before birth. Of Yahshua. They're both the same. Because when you add them together, it's going to come out to 4004 BBY all together from Adam to Yahshua. But we know there's a 4-year error. The 4-year error was spotted by Usher. This, you can look him up. Archbishop Usher. See, he was the one that spotted the error and pushed it back 4 years. That's why when you see in most Bibles, when you look up Jesus Christ, it'll say this, most cases, it'll say 4 BC to 29 AD. And that's okay. Because it's taking a compensation of the error. Because when you subtract it, it's still 4,000 years. It's still 4,000 years from Adam to Yahshua. Okay? All right. Now, take a picture of it or whatever, because I'm going to erase it. And I got to get, now I'm going to go back to this. 1491, okay? Get Daniel 9:24, because I went through this the other day in part, so I'm going to bring it up, in the use of it, we're going to show the principle of the fourth generation. Okay?
Daniel 9:24. 70 weeks of years are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to restrain transgression and make an end of sin offering and to make atonement for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to complete the prophetic vision, and to anoint the holy place.
Okay, 70 weeks of years. That just simply means 70 times 7, which is 490. It's just Yahweh operating in perfection. Okay? Now, if you remember what I put up the other day, about Abraham. Abraham was 75 years old when he received the promise.
Right.
All right. Which was 430 years before the Mosaic Law, which would give you 505 years. And just to make a long story short, we took Ishmael,
right,
who was 15 years old when he was cast out because he was a child of the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
He was circumcised out of Abraham's life. So those 15 years is circumcised out of Abraham's life to give you 490. So from Abraham's birth, and we have it up here, from Abraham's birth to the Mosaic Law is 490 years, minus the 15, with the 15 years minus cut out,
right,
of, you know, out of his life, meaning Ishmael. Okay? All right? So, now it says 1490 up here, but I'm going to use 1491.
Okay.
Okay? for this particular reason, because I want to show the principle of the fourth generation as it goes down in the law and the prophets, okay? Now, we said, in this case, 1491 BBY, and then we got 490 years from that. That would be 1001 BBY. Okay, now, what's so significant about that? This is when the temple was temporary. This is when Solomon's temple was dedicated. In fact, I remember in the old days, before we had blackboards and whiteboards, they would use the charts to use calculations. This is what they used to do. They would say this, all right, it's 2513 a.m. coming up out of Egypt. Moses coming up here, all right, into the cloud. He sees this vision, all right, and each vision counts a day for a year. And there's 7 days, so 7 plus 2513 would give you 2520. Okay? I mean, I'm just showing you how they would use pictures to show the numbers. Yeah. Or they would say, look, all right, when the Israelites came up out of Egypt, they spent 40 years in the wilderness of Sinai. Then they crossed over the River Jordan. From the time they crossed the River Jordan to Solomon's temple being dedicated, it's 450 years. And then from Solomon's temple to the birth of Yahshua the Messiah is 1,000 years. 40 plus 450 plus 1,000, that's 1490. Or 1490 years before Yahshua. See? See, that's the way they used to show, that's the way they used to teach us before we, you know, got fancy with numbers and stuff. They should just show us on the board. You remember that, Dr. Bird? They used to show, they would just show us on the chart how the, what the numbers meant. You know, 40 years here from the River Jordan, across the River Jordan to the temple, Solomon's temple, the dedication is 450 years. Then from the dedication of the temple to the birth of Yahshua the Messiah is 1,000 years. 1,000 plus 450 plus 40 is 1490. See, that kind of thing. All right? So now, when this happened, okay, now, how can I put this? Let's backtrack just a smidgen. Let's talk about after they come up here in Canaan's land. Okay? Now, Joshua took over after the death of Moses. Moses died at 120 years old. He was buried here by angels on this side of the Jordan at Mount Nebo. And Joshua took over. And Joshua fought for Canaan's land for 40 years, for the conquest of Canaan's land, okay? 40 years in the conquest. And then when he died, then there was a period of judges that took over. There were 15 judges that judge Israel until they received their first king, who was Saul from the tribe of Benjamin. And then all the 12 tribes were united under one monarchy. First under Saul, who ruled for 40 years, then under David, who ruled for 40 years, and then under Solomon, who ruled for 40 years. Maybe we should read that. Get 1 Kings, First Kings 12th chapter, okay. No, let's get 11 and 41. Let's start there.
1 Kings 11 and 41. And the rest of the acts of Solomon and all that he did and his wisdom are not written in the book of the Acts of Solomon. And the time that Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all Israel was 40 years. And Solomon slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David, his father, and Rehoboam, his son, reigned in his stead.
Okay, so now let's just get this recapitulate. The first generation was Saul, a united monarchy. So the first king under the united monarchy was Saul. The second king was David. The third king was Solomon. Now here's the fourth king, or the fourth generation, which is Rehoboam. Let's read about him.
And 12, and Rehoboam went to Shechem, for all Israel were come to Shechem to make him king. And it came to pass, when Jeroboam the son of Nebat, who was yet in Egypt, heard of it, for he was fled from the presence of King Solomon, and Jeroboam dwelt in Egypt, that they sent and called him. And Jeroboam and all the congregation of Israel came and spake unto Jeroboam, saying, thy father made our yoke grievous. Now therefore make thou the grievous service of thy father, and his heavy yoke which he put upon us lighter, and we will serve thee. And he said unto them, Depart yet for 3 days, then come again to me. And the people departed. And King Rehoboam consulted with the old men that stood before Solomon his father while he yet lived, and said, how do ye advise that I may answer this people? And they spake unto him, saying, if thou wilt be a servant unto this people this day, and wilt serve them, and answer them, and speak good words to them, then they will be thy servants forever. But he forsook the counsel of the old men which they had given him, and consulted with the young men that were grown up with him, and which stood before him. And he said unto them, what counsel give ye that we may answer this people who has spoken to me, saying, make the yoke which thy father did put upon us lighter? And the young men that were grown up with him spake unto him, saying, thus shalt thou speak unto the people that spake unto thee, saying, thy father made our yoke heavy, but make thou it lighter unto us. Thus shalt thou say unto them, my little finger shall be thicker than my father's loins. And now, whereas my father did laid you with a heavy yoke, I will add to your yoke my father has chastised you with whips, but I will chastise you with scorpions. Wow. So Jeroboam and all the people came to Rehoboam the third day, as the king had appointed, saying, come to me again the third day. And the king answered the people roughly, and forsook the old men's counsel that they gave him, and spake to them, saying, after the counsel of the young men, saying, my father made your yoke heavy, and I will add to your yoke. My father also chastised you with whips, but I will chastise you with scorpions. Wherefore the king hearkened not unto the people, for the cause was from Yahweh, that he might perform his saying which Yahweh spake by Ahijah and Shilonite unto Jeroboam the son of Nebat. So when all Israel saw that the king hearkened not unto them, the people answered the king, saying, what portion have we in David? Neither have we inheritance in the son of Jesse. To your tents, O Israel. Now see to thine own house, David. So Israel departed unto their tents. But as for the children of Israel, which dwelt in the cities of Judah, Rehoboam reigned over them.
Okay, now, this is where the 12 tribes divided. Okay, the 10 tribes, they left and united under Jeroboam. And the other two tribes that stayed was Judah and Benjamin, and they stayed under Rehoboam. Okay, but this was in the fourth generation. And this is what, jump down to the 25th verse.
25. Then Jeroboam built Shechem in Mount Ephraim, and dwelt therein, mm-hmm. and went out from thence, and built Penuel. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of Yahweh at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto the king, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me, mm-hmm. and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah.
In other words, he said, well, look, I got to come up with a place for they can worship. Because they would go to worship at Jerusalem because the temple was there. So now Jeroboam said, well, I got to come up with something, you know, something similar myself. So this is his idea that what he's going to do. Read.
Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, It is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold, thy deities, O Israel.
And now, thy deities, two calves of gold. It was bad enough they made one calf down here in the wilderness.
Yeah.
In the wilderness, as if they didn't learn that lesson. But now here they are up here, and Jeroboam said, okay, well, let's make two calves of gold so everybody can come here and worship instead of going to the temple in Jerusalem. That's how he's thinking. Okay? Read.
For you to go up to Jerusalem, behold, thy deities, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And he set the one in Bethel and the other in Dan.
Okay, now, why is it like that? Didn't Moses write about that down here? This is in the prophets. Mm-hmm. So it's drawn out from that. Mm-hmm. And it's just a repeat of that.
Right.
See, the iniquity. Mm-hmm. See, unto the third and the fourth generation.
Okay.
Okay? Now, I'm thinking something here. I think it's in Ezekiel, I think, what I want. To 26. I know it's in Ezekiel. Ezekiel 16th chapter. I knew it was a six in there.
And one?
Yeah, you can start there.
Ezekiel 16 and 1. Again, the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations, and say, Thus saith Yahweh Elohim unto Jerusalem, Thy birth and thy nativity is of the land of Canaan. Thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother an Hittite.
I said that his father was an Amorite. Remember what we read in Genesis about Abraham, about the iniquity of the Amorites? Okay, read.
And as for thy nativity, in the day thou wast born, thy navel was not cut, neither wast thou washed in water to supple thee. Thou wast not salted at all, nor swaddled at all. None eyes pitied thee to do any of these upon thee, unto thee, to have compassion upon thee. But thou wast cast out in the open field to the loathing of thy person in the day that thou wast born. And when I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, When thou wast in thy blood, live. Yea, I said unto thee, When thou wast in thy blood, live or live. I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, and thou hast increased and waxen great. And thou art come to excellent ornaments, thy breasts are fashioned, and thine hair is grown, whereas thou wast naked and bare. Now when I pass by thee and look upon thee, behold, thy time was a time of love, and I spread my skirt over thee and covered thy nakedness. Yea, I swear unto thee and entered into a covenant with thee, saith Yahweh Elohim, and thou becamest mine. Then washed I thee with water, yea, I thoroughly washed away thy blood from thee, and I anointed thee with oil. I clothed thee also with embroidered work, and shod thee with badger skin, and I girded thee about with fine linen, and covered thee with silk. I decked thee also with ornaments, and I put bracelets upon thy hands, and a chain on thy neck. And I put a jewel on thy forehead, and earrings in thine ears, and a beautiful crown upon thine head. Thou wast not decked with gold and silver, and thy raiment was of fine linen and silk, and embroidered work. Thou didst eat fine flour, and honey, and oil, and thou wast exceeding beautiful, and thou didst prosper unto a kingdom. And thy renown went forth among the heathen for a beauty, for it was perfect through thy comeliness, which I had put upon thee, saith Yahweh Elohim. But thou didst trust in thine own beauty, and playedst the harlot because of thy renown, and pouredst out thy fornications on everyone that passed by, his it was. And of thy garments thou didst take, and deck thy high places with divers colors, and played the harlot thereupon. The like thing shall not come, neither shall it be so.
Okay. Read the next one. I like to read the next one.
17. Thou hast also taken thy fair jewels of my gold and of my silver, which I had given thee, and madest to thyself images of men, and didst commit whoredom with them.
Okay, good enough. All right. See, you made images of men, and you made love to them. Mm-hmm. You know? You know, no.
What do you mean, images of men?
Images of the doctrines. Idols. Idols. You know, and they made love. They fell down. They did whatever. They sacrificed to them. They, you know, I mean, it's the same thing. You know, they made love to the idols, mm-hmm, as opposed to obeying Yahweh, who made love to them out here in the wilderness, because He married them out here, and that was his wife. And then here she is up here. She going with everybody, every Tom, Dick, and Harry, you know, so to speak. You know,
whore.
See, you know, it's like almost like he playing the dozen. Yeah, your daddy was an Amorite and your mama was a Hittite. But see, he told them, see, but you have to put all things in context and put it all together. Because Yahweh told them before they came up here, do not follow their idols, tear them down, and then, you know, don't follow their ways, all that kind of stuff. And they did, just that.
All of it.
Mm-hmm. See. See. See, the fourth generation. See, the principle of the fourth generation, see, and this is where I want to get back to over here. Because, see, we read that in Exodus, that Yahweh would visit the iniquities upon the children, upon the third and fourth generation. Well, let's add this in here. 1001 is the year of the dedication. All right? Now, 3 years, it took 3 years for the dedication. See, in other words, the temple was built, was finished in the year 1004. All right, this is the temple was finished in 1004. This is the dedication began. It took 3 years for the dedication. All right, and so it was finished by 1001, or 1,500, technically speaking. Okay, but I'm keeping this in here for a reason. All right, because I want to show something else in this. All right, now I said unto the third and the fourth generation. Now get 2 Kings 24:1.
Second Kings 24:1.
Uh-huh.
In his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his servant 3 years.
All right. Now, Nebuchadnezzar came up from Babylon. The question you want to ask is, what year did Nebuchadnezzar come up from Babylon? All right. 400 years. Because, see, 400 years. Four. The third and fourth generation. We'll take the four, and zeros are placeholders,
right,
to be added or subtracted. In this case, we'll add them to the four for 400 years. BBY. Mm-hmm. This is the year Nebuchadnezzar came up from Babylon and took over. He took over Judah without a fight, because they had no way they could resist him. Pretty much just walked in on the guy and just slapped him and said, "We running things now." All right, we'll let you still sit here. You know, you can be the HNIC, but we're running it, okay? We want our cut every year, all right?
In my footnote, it says 605 BC.
I know, that's them, but I'm using divine measurements.
Oh.
All right?
So I should correct that, huh?
Well, you do what you want with your Bible, okay? But I'm showing you the way Dr. Kinley laid it out.
All right.
According to a divine pattern and divine calculations. All right, so 604 was when Nebuchadnezzar came. And read that other line again.
Then he turned and rebelled.
The line before that.
Oh, in his day, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his servant.
Became his servant.
3 years.
No, wait a minute. He became his servant, and that was in 604. Okay, and then 3 years what?
Became his servant 3 years.
Became his servant for 3 years. In 604, he became his servant, and he was his servant for 3 years, and then what?
Then he turned and rebelled against
him. Then he rebelled.
Oh, 601. Oh, okay.
That would be 601. BBY. This is the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. Mm-hmm. See? And read on.
Okay. And Yahweh sent against him bands of the Chaldeans, and bands of the Syrians, and bands of the Moabites, and bands of the children of Ammon, and sent them against Judah to destroy it, according to the word of Yahweh, which he spake by his servant, the prophets.
Because he spake by his servants, the prophet. We can get persnickety with that and show you which prophet spoke it. Okay? But this is what I'm trying to show you here. This is the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. Okay? Right here, in the which is at the end of the third and fourth generation, or 400 years. Get it? Mm-hmm. Daniel 1. Let's just throw that in there, just to show you that we're talking about the same thing.
Daniel 1. The word of Yahweh that came unto Hosea the son of Beeri.
Daniel.
Oops.
In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem.
Now, we just read that he served him 3 years. It's 601.
Right.
Read.
Right. And besieged it.
Uh-huh.
And Yahweh gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with the part of the vessel of the house of Elohim, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his deity.
Mm-hmm.
And he brought the vessels into the treasure city, the treasure house of his deity. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes, children in whom were no blemish, but well favored and skillful in all wisdom, and skillful in knowledge and understanding science, and such had all ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and okay, whom they might teach the learning and the tongue.
Okay, of the good enough. I just wanted to have that read to show. This is when the first deportation began, in 601 BBY. This is the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. This is when the Israelites lose their land. They're taken off of their land. This is the 3 years that they were under servitude in their own land represented the seventh servitude that they had been under in their own land. They had been under six previous servitudes under the judges. Okay, and so now with Jehoiakim, the 3 years that he served under Nebuchadnezzar was the last servitude or the seventh servitude in their own land. But the point I'm making is showing you that in principle, showing you that them being deported. That's the fourth generation. It's 400 years from the temple being dedicated, or the third and fourth, or the fourth generation in principle. That's all I'm showing you here. That's the fourth generation. Okay? Now, yeah.
Does it matter when Jehoiakim was it? I thought he left out with the ten, and Rehoboam stayed in Jerusalem.
Now, Rehoboam, Jehoiakim is much further down the line. See, because almost 400 years down the line, because Rehoboam is the son of Solomon. Okay?
Israel was captive, right?
Yeah.
Let me see. 1 Kings, what I want. I want Shishak. That's what I want. First Kings 14 and 25. See, now this happened under. Start with 21.
1 Kings 14 and 21.
Uh-huh.
And Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, reigned in Judah.
Mm-hmm.
Rehoboam was 41 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 17 years in Jerusalem, the city which Yahweh did choose out of all the tribes of Israel to put his name there. And his mother's name was Naamah and Ammonitis.
The Ammonitis. Because remember, Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. All right? And they all weren't Hebrew either. They didn't all come from the 12 tribes of Israel. Not all of them. Because he married, you can read about it, he married the sister of the Pharaoh of Egypt. It's in the scripture there. And so now here's another one. He married an Ammonite. They were for political reason, but I'm sure he knocked on that door late at night and said, excuse me.
Is your husband.
You know? I'm here to perform my kingly duties. You know, I am the master potentate here. Read, please.
22, and Judah did evil in the sight of Yahweh, and they provoked him to jealousy with their sins which they had committed above all that their fathers had done. For they also built them high places and images, and groves on every high hill, and under every green tree. And there were also Sodomites in the land, and they did according to all the abominations of the nations which Yahweh cast out before the children of Israel.
Now this is Rehoboam, who's the fourth generation. Right? The iniquity of the third and the fourth generation. If that ain't iniquity in the fourth generation, I don't know what is. Okay, continue.
And it came to pass in the fifth year of King Rehoboam that Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem. And he took away the treasures of the house of Yahweh and the treasures of the king's house. He even took away all, and he took away all the shields of gold which Solomon had made. And King Rehoboam made in their stead brazen and shields and committed them unto the hands of the chief of the guard which kept the door of the king's house. And it was so, when the king went into the house of Yahweh, that the guard bare them and brought them back into the guard chamber.
All right. Now, Shishak, this is when this is the first time Solomon's temple has been molested. Hmm. All right. Now, Shishak, he raided the temple, but he did not take the main articles of the temple, you know, like the Ark of the Covenant or the Table of Shewbread. He just took the gold plates and stuff like that, and you know, yeah. And you know, but even that's a principle, because Solomon's temple was finished in 1004, and so when Shishak raided it, it just happens to be 33 years after it was completed. Why? Because it points up to Yahshua the Messiah. His body, or the temple of his body, was not molested for 33 years until they put him on the cross. Mm-hmm. See, that's what that's pointing to. Okay? But that happened in the fourth generation. See? The fourth generation, the iniquity, see? And Yahweh visits us, the iniquity, you know. Of he just keeps visiting, you know. Yeah. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
All right? Now.
How come it doesn't mention the third generation?
I'm sorry?
It doesn't mention the third generation. It's all the fourth. When they say the third and the fourth, but most of this happens in the
it's
fourth.
It's happening on the fourth because that's the principle we're concentrating on. All right? So, yeah, you know, the third and the fourth generation. It just seems to be a recurring principle, just like what we showed you with the Tower of Babel. That happened in the fourth generation of mankind. Mm-hmm. See? So, and these things happen in the third and the fourth. It's just a principle that just keeps reoccurring, you know, if you will. All right? I suppose if I was to bring it to the modern, Visuals in 1931, and in 1958, that's when 70 souls left Ohio and they came to California. That was the first year, and these were people that were using, they were still using Lord God and Jesus Christ. Okay, all right, and they were in Ohio and then Springfield, and then they came out here to L.A. All right, and so the second generation. From 1958 to, I would say, 1976, yes. The death of Dr. Kinley took off this flesh February 9th, 1976. All right. Now, he came out here in 58, and it was brought out by Dr. Bud once about movies and stuff, because he wanted to make movies. In fact, here's something a lot of people may not realize. The textbook, our textbook, really, God the Archetype Original Pattern and the 69 edition, Elohim the Archetype Original Pattern, really, when you stop and look at it, it's really the template for a movie script, to be honest with you. Because they got people, when they came out here, they came in together with some people, and they met with some folks, some noted script writers, and they looked at the charts. You know, they looked at these, and it's not a stretch for them, because I learned this in school, that these charts and plates, they look just like storyboards in a movie, because that's what you make. You know, not just a script, but you make a storyboard to illustrate what it is that you want to portray. And it gives something the director, you know, something to look at, even though he's going to put his stamp on it. But it gives a visual outline of what it is you're trying to show. And there was some night. Hey, there was some talented scriptwriters. They weren't just some fly by night. In fact, Dennis Drouard told me this. He told me that one of the guys that was one of the scriptwriters that, you know, who looked at this work. You know, and they all got together. He was one of them, but they all got together and concluded that they said it was too much for them. They couldn't write a scenario for it. Dennis Drouard told me that one of the guys that looked at it was a guy named Sterling Siliphant. Mm-hmm. Now, if you don't know who Sterling Siliphant is, not at that time, because this was back in 58, you know, but several years later, this guy's talent, just to show you how talented this guy won an Academy Award for a script that he wrote. That script is called In the Heat of the Night, starring Sidney Poitier and Rod Steiger.
Right.
Yeah, this guy won an Academy Award. He was one of the guys that looked this vision over and said he could not write a scenario for it. This is a guy whose talent was at Academy Award level. Mm-hmm. Talent. And he couldn't write a scenario for it. And I'll tell you something else. I took an advanced script writing class at Santa Monica. And the guy, and I'm telling you, the guy, my instructor, one of the themes that he liked to deal with was Sterling Silliphant. And we had to dissect that script. You know, just to show, I mean, because it was an Academy Award script. So therefore, it was worth looking at, okay, what did he do right that made the script work, that made the director was able to do this and that. And we were watching clips of the film. We was going over his script. Oh, man, it was just, and the guy was a genius. He was really brilliant by the way, you know, the way he wrote the script and how he presented his material on there and the way the director was able to translate that to the screen. But he wasn't able to translate this vision.
Yeah.
Now, how about that? You know, he's an Academy Award winning script writer, you know, but he looked at this vision and said, we can't write a scenario for it. Okay? So, now, in this period, you had people that went out and started classes. You know, you had people like, you know, the Rip Macklins, the Burbank Mitchells, the Jonesies, you know, Edward Mixon, you know, who else? Who? You know, you had folks going out. Yeah, you know, this was the period of where they went out and started classes. You know, there were people starting classes in different countries and stuff. You know, in Canada, and I remember that lady. What was her name? Ruth Mortimer, the chick from the net. Who?
Estelle Ellenberg. She was in Austria.
Oh yes, that's right. That's right. So it was expanding, all right. And so the textbook went out. There was the peace mission that went out in 1971, Dr. Kinley went on that peace mission, 1971. And then there were two more peace missions that he didn't go on. But I'm just saying, this was the growth. This was the, you know, it was the fun days, I used to always say, because, you know, there was not seminars, there were conventions. We had regions, right? There were, you know, we had the northern, southern, eastern, western regions. Then we had international conventions on the odd years. And then we had state conventions or state seminars on the even years, if I remember correctly. So but 1975 was the last of the international conventions. And then he said, well, do the regionals, and, you know, that kind of thing. All right, so now, but that's that generation, all right? I came in during this time, at the end of this, myself. I mean, I met Dr. Kinley personally. You know, that was an experience. Anybody that's ever met Dr. Kinley personally has had an experience, okay? Let's just put that out there. I don't care who you are. Anybody that's ever met him can talk about a Kinley experience of some sort. Something that, you know, that just was out of the ordinary, if you will, you know, so to speak, okay? Okay, third generation, 1976 to 1989. All right, Dr. Kinley's gone, and this is where, you know, things begin to start popping. People begin to start talking stuff like, well, things I couldn't tell you before, I can tell you now. Different doctrines and stuff. And I have 1989 here. Because 1989 is the year that the copyright for the first edition of the textbook, God the Archetype, that's when it ran out. See, because according to the laws, the laws of the land at that time, the copyright laws, if you copyright something in the year 1961, the copyright law would last for 28 years, and then you had to renew it. Mm-hmm. All right, 28 years. See, would bring you to 1989. Okay. Now, that means this: IDMR had till the end of the year this year to renew the copyright ownership, otherwise it would slip into public domain, which is what happened January 1st, 1990. So God the Archetype original pattern, which is the first edition of our textbook, is officially, and has been, in public domain. Now, the second edition of our textbook, which is Elohim, the Archetype Original Pattern, all right, that was published in 1969. That is still owned. It's owned by the Kinley family, well, particularly the Glenn Kinley family, that part of the family. Because what happened was, and this was the thing they didn't tell us about, I had to do the research on it, Glenn Kinley wrote a textbook of his own. He wrote his own textbook. And because he was the son of the author of the original two books, when he filed his book for copyright status, they said, well, you can't, they probably just told him, well, you can't use that name because it belongs to another name, a guy named Henry Clifford Kinley. And he probably said, oh, well, that's my daddy. Oh, you're the son of this author of this. Oh, so what are you trying to say? That your book is a continuing work of your father's work? Yes, I am. Therefore, and see, copyright laws have changed tremendously over the years, mostly because the big corporations have done it, because they want to extend their properties, particularly companies like Disney and, you know, some of the biggest, you know, because Disney owns Mickey Mouse forever. And the reason why they've done it is because they've lobbied to have copyright laws changed so that they can continue ownership so it don't lapse into public domain. Okay? See, so family in copyright law, for the most part, will trump a corporation. So the family, the Kinley family in this case, trumped the corporation IDMR because Glenn Kinley is the biological son of Henry Clifford Kinley, and he wrote a book, and he was able to use that book to claim a continuing work of his father. So because of that, the government gave him leeway and gave him ownership. See? That's why they came out headquarters years ago and said, with a disc, well, we can't do this, we can't, you know, sell it, because they lost the ownership of it. Yeah. They don't, you know, they don't even own the charts. I mean, they don't like me telling you that, but that's the truth. They don't own these charts. In fact, I'll tell you this, the pamphlets that we use, they're in public domain. That's something that nobody don't talk about. The pink pamphlet and all those pamphlets, they're in public domain now because, one, they never registered them. It's just that simple. And because they never registered them, years just lapsed. And so nobody really owns it. It's just really pretty much kind of like just lapsed into public domain. You know, so, and I think that would be okay with Dr. Kinley, because if it was up to him, he would fly over the populace with an airplane and just throw the material out. You know, if it was up to him, see. In fact, the only reason why we even get involved with copyrights and stuff like that is so that people won't come along and take it from us and prevent us from using it. All right? That's really the only reason. But as far as somebody else taking this work and preaching it and spreading it or whatever, have at it. Yeah. You know, Dr. Kinley wouldn't have cared. He would just leave him alone. Let him do it. As long as they can't stop us from using this material, Dr. Kinley would be like, you know, if they want to use it, let them. It's okay. Am I correct, Dr. Bud? You know, that's what I've always understood that, you know. So, I mean, that he was like that, you know. So, use it, so what? You know, somebody used it at work and, you know, we need to sue them. No, I mean, they're spreading over our name. Somebody will look at this and see it. The Spirit will show them something. See? And listen, here's another reason about this. See, and let's get Revelations. I think it's the third chapter.
Revelations 3.
Wait, let me see if it's the right one. King David. It's Revelations 2, actually. 2:1, start there.
Unto the messenger of the assembly of Ephesus write, these things said he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walked in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first work, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hateth hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the assemblies. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the garden of Yahweh.
All right. Go back to the fourth verse and read that, 4 and 5.
Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love.
He said, I have somewhat something against you because thou hast left thy first love. This is what we got started with, because we read that in Ezekiel about being a hoe.
Yeah.
and thou hast left thy first love. Mm-hmm. Well, who was thy first love? Well, see, in this school, your first love, and by the way, only love,
only. That's
right. Is Elohim, the archetype original pattern.
That's right.
Who is the resurrected Yahshua, the Messiah? Mm-hmm. And see, you have left thy first love. See, that's what has happened.
Yeah.
To this, read.
Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, go ahead.
And repent and do the first work, mm-hmm. or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent.
Now I will move your candlestick or your lampstand.
Right.
Now where's the lampstand at here? It's in the holy place, and it lights up.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, accordingly, they would light this lampstand at 3:00 in the afternoon. And the reason why is because it would shine until 9:00 the next day, because at 9:00 they would put this out, mm-hmm. and this tabernacle, which would be set up facing east, the sun would shine right through it. Okay. But now, if the sun ain't shining in here, and the lampstand is removed, then this whole holy place is dark. You in the dark.
That's right.
I will remove your lampstand. I will remove your illumination.
Yes.
I will remove your understanding.
Yes.
I will remove your knowledge.
Yep.
See? And you'll be in the dark. See? Come over here. Here you are. Because the scripture says, and people harp on this, stand in the holy place. But if you're standing in the holy place, now you're supposed to be on the path of the way, the truth, the life. But if you ain't on this path and you're doing something else, and you done forgot your first love and you're in the holy place, then I will remove your lampstand and then you'll be in the dark. What do you mean? You'll be in the dark here with these false prophets and deceivers and concepts and theories and opinions and Satan's ministers. And here is the Pope out here. You'll be out there in the dark with them, entertaining them. See? And then this holy place that you were supposed to be standing in now becomes an unholy place for you, because now your lampstand has been taken, has been removed. See, that's what happened up here with the Israelites. Talking about these folks that came up out of Egypt, 603,550. See, they died out here because of unbelief. They were not, the lampstand had been removed because of unbelief. They were not illuminated. Their lampstand were removed. And they died in the holy place. They were supposed to be standing in the holy place, but they died there in the dark. In ignorance, in unbelief. See, whereas the new birth went over and claimed their inheritance. See. See, don't forget about your first, see, your first love. And look, you're in the holy place. And your first love is right there with you in the holy place, this tabernacle pattern. Yes. It's right there with you.
Right.
And you fall in that cloud. But if you forget your first love, then I'm going to remove your lampstand, and you'll be in the dark. And then you know how you are in the dark. You'll be aimless, bumping around. Somebody has to come lead you by the hand, and you don't know who's leading. Oh yeah, I'm here to help you. You don't know who it is. Come on, yeah, just trust me. Come on. I'm like, all right, you don't know because you're in the dark. Your lampstand is removed. And that's what's happened in the fourth generation of this school. Since then, because since 1989, in 1989, 1990, that's when we get the birth son doctrine. That's been going on since then. And that is the fourth generation. From 1989 to the present. That's the we're in the fourth generation now. And what is the doctrine that's prevalent in IDMR now? Idolatry. What do we read in Ezekiel? They're making idols in the shapes and forms of men and making love to them. They're making idols in the shape and forms of a man and making love to them, worshiping them. The fourth generation. Your daddy was an Amorite and your mama was a Hittite. Maybe we should read that. I think it's in Leviticus, maybe. I'm thinking 11 or 16 or somewhere around there. No, I'm thinking. Or maybe it's Numbers, I'm thinking. Maybe it's Numbers 6, maybe Numbers. No, that's not it.
Deuteronomy?
I'm sorry, what you got?
I said Deuteronomy.
No, it's not. I'm going to have to cheat and find a reference. it talks about when you go into the land, this is not what you're supposed to do, and this kind of thing. Let's see. Leviticus 18. Let's try that. Yeah, that's it. Leviticus 18 and 1. Quickly.
Leviticus 18 and 1. And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, I am Yahweh your Elohim. After the doings of the land of Egypt, wherein ye dwelt, shall ye not do. And after the doings of the land of Canaan, whither I bring you, shall ye not do neither. Neither shall ye walk in their ordinances. You shall do my judgments and keep mine ordinances. To walk therein, I am Yahweh your Elohim. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, which if a man do, he shall live in them. I am Yahweh. None of you shall approach to any that is near of kin to him to uncover their nakedness. I am Yahweh. The nakedness of thy father or the nakedness of thy mother shalt thou not uncover. She is thy mother. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness.
Okay, that's good enough. It just basically goes on and tells you about that when you go up into the land of Canaan, which I'm going to bring you in, you're not going to do what they do. You're not going to walk in their ordinances. You're not going to do their statutes. You're going to walk in mine. Okay?
Right.
See, that's the difference. All right? But that's what... But this is what happened to them. They did. They became part of them. Mm-hmm. They adapted them.
Yeah.
Right? Even to the point, Solomon, like I said, he had 700 wives, 300 concubines. Most of them were foreign women. You know, like we just read about Rehoboam. His mom was an Ammonite. Was an Ammonite, you know? Yeah, so, you know, but he can say, well, but my dad was the king. You know, I'm Hebrew, you know, so I'm Jewish, I'm Judah, you know, that kind of thing. But his mom was still worshiping. And Solomon, and they'll tell you, Solomon, can we get it? Let's swear into that. First Kings. First Kings 11 and 1.
Kings 11 and 1. But King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites.
See, he had them all. He keep going. No,
of the nations concerning which Yahweh said unto the children of Israel, you shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their idols. Solomon clave unto these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other idols, and his heart was not perfect with Yahweh his Elohim. His was the heart of David, his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. And Solomon did evil in the sight of Yahweh, and went not fully after Yahweh, as did David, his father. Then did Solomon build an high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. Likewise did he for all his strange wives, which burnt incense and sacrificed unto their gods.
Okay, good enough. See, now you asked the question earlier about what about the third generation? Well, that was Solomon right there. Mm-hmm. That was the third generation. He's the father of Rehoboam, who was the fourth. So it's in the third and fourth generation. Well, that's the third generation right there. And there's Solomon, you know, wisest man in the world, supposedly, before his wisdom. And yet here he is, you know.
Wise and horny.
You know, I'm telling you, women can do a thing to a man, you know. Especially if you got he's got 1,000 women. He's got, you know, because they, as soon as one comes in, baby, can you do this? Can you do that? And then as soon as one leaves, another one comes in. Say, baby, yeah, you know, I mean, can you imagine that? And then they got children, and they go to try. And listen, these women ain't stupid. They want to have a child, a son. Why? Because the son could be king. Yeah, they be jockeying for positions, you know. I mean, if they were to do a reality show, you know, like, you know, the reality show, they could call it The Wives of Solomon or something, you know. And just follow them around the palace and how one would be scheming on the other and plotting and planning and that kind of thing. Palace intrigues and stuff. You know, that happens all the time. Okay. All right. Any questions, comments, or anything? I hope that answers the question about the fourth generation. It's a principle. And it's just showing you that the fourth generation is the one that goes into iniquity. All right? And it's just a repeat because we see the same thing today. But the thing of it is to come out of that. See?
Coming in on the fourth day, as far as expelling that?
Well, I don't know if I want to I don't know if I would want to do it like that. You know, I know the fourth day, you know, I usually keep it like the 4,000 years. Yeah, you know, I mean, when you say the fourth day, the sun being placed in there is like the 4,000 year Yahshua comes in. So
they expel that iniquitous generation of that of the first to the fourth, third and the fourth, and then now the start, because you have the beginning of the Messiah.
Well, I mean,
hard to press that.
Yeah. To me, it would be. I wouldn't. If you could do it and figure out the words to the language for it, have at it. Me, I probably wouldn't. I would just keep it separate. I could say the fourth day, 4,000 years, and then when I talk about these generations, just what I was going through as far as the fourth generation, because really I didn't go through it. I think these people out here, they were like the fourth generation coming down, you know, from, because you stop and think, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and then 70 souls came down, and those 70 souls became 12 tribes. See, so from the fourth generation of those souls that came down, you can see the extrapolation like that, the fourth generation. So it's just a principle that just seems to repeat itself, that Yahweh is showing that, you know, okay, here's the iniquity, he's pointing it out, but also out of that, you're going to see the salvation coming up out of that. See, the salvation is going to come out of that, coming out of Babylon, or coming out of that iniquity, just like we are. We came up out of this, but we didn't stay in it. We didn't, you know, because we continued on, all right, see, all the way up to here. See, this is where you, see, this is all a process. You got to come up out of Egypt. See, and come into the wilderness. In the wilderness, there is light, illumination. There is bread, sustenance. See, there is an intercessor. Okay? There is a pattern. See? And then we use this to grow so that there is a new birth here. See, this is where you receive the Holy Spirit. So that from here, then you can go on into here to be sealed. See, for Yahweh to be able to take your lampstand away from here means you were not sealed. See, you could be anointed with the Holy Spirit and operated by the Holy Spirit, but unless you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, then you're subjected to all these distractions out here. Once you are sealed with the Holy Spirit, then you've crossed over. See, look, come over here. Draw a line. This veil is rent. And the flash of the Shekinah in your heart and mind. Yahshua is appearing there in your heart and mind. You are sealed in him. Or as Dr. Kinley used to say, there's no breaking in after that. Or how you say it, brother? How do you say it? There's no backsliding because you didn't slide in? You didn't slide in far enough?
No such thing as backsliding. You haven't slid far enough in front.
That's it. All right, that's the thing. See, so that's what we want you to do. We want you to slide all the way in to here. This is where you are. This is where we want you to be. See, be in Yahshua, who is in the bosom of the Father. See, that's where you want to be. One more scripture and I'll be done. Galatians 3. I think it's 3 or maybe 4:21.
Galatians 4:21.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid and the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise, which things are an allegory. For these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above all, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, Rejoice, thou barren that bearest not, break forth and cry, thou that travailest not, for the desolate hath many more children than she which hath a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the Spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the Scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. Stand fast.
Okay, good enough. All right. We are not come to Mount Sinai, which is in Arabia, which gendereth to bondage, or the law of carnal ordinances. That's really what he's talking about, which is bondage. But we are come to Mount, Jerusalem above, which is free. In other words, you are translated into the kingdom here. All right, and as we was reading there, see, the cast said, cast out the bondwoman and her son, because she's not going to be heir. With my father. See, that's what we was going through the other day, that Ishmael was circumcised, out of his life. The flesh, that's what it's pointing to. The flesh, the iniquity. See, it's the same way here. We're children of the free, not the bond. We're children of the righteous, not of the iniquity. We're of the generation of the righteous, not the generation of the iniquity. See, that's the generation, because that generation was fulfilled by Yahshua. And I can get into some more. We didn't really touch it like we could have, because he came in the likeness of sinful flesh and was numbered with the transgressors. So he fulfilled that generation so that now you can come out new and afresh, clean, as if it were. See, and the good news is that Yahshua Messiah has made a way for you to be translated into his kingdom.
Right.
See, and that you would be in him in glory throughout eternity. See, all right? That's what we want you to be. We don't want you to be. See, the world now is part of the fourth generation that's going to be cast into the lake of fire. And see, and Yahweh has already determined and judged that. The thing we want you to be is to be free from that. As the scripture says, you're children of the free, children of the light, see, children of the day, all right? No matter what happens around us and the turmoil and all,
that's right.
Be in Yahshua, see, all right? Who is the light, okay? Thank you for your time and your patience. Be safe, be healthy, but most of all, be in Yahshua, who is your only hope of glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All righty, that concludes tonight's workshop. Are there any announcements?
Business meeting this Sunday at 10:15.
All righty, business meeting this Sunday at 10:15. Okay, very good lecture. I got a lot of stuff out of it, principles. Okay, we have classes here, 11 to 1 on Sundays, Tuesdays 30, 7:30, 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser, our treasurer. Let us all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy. To the only by the Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua the Star, our Sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
If somebody had signed in that hadn't on the YouTube, not YouTube, but these.
Well, like I say, I just, on the sideline, the people that are not on there, I just write the names down of everybody that.
Yeah, somebody was on the Facebook that.
So whenever they do decide they want to get on the list.
I started to write some of them down.
You got those on Facebook. I got the ones on YouTube.
Uh-huh. Would it be in here?
Huh?
Will it be in here? There, if I go to Facebook?
Uh,